Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Professor Rekha Pande from the Department of History in the University of Hyderabad. I am going to do a module on the Bhakti movement, its background, and what was the male attitude towards women in this movement. This is part of the Women's Studies third module on women and history. Now, when we look at 13th century, this was a period where there were many changes which occurred in India. And you had the emergence of a large number of new social groups that did not fit the traditional hierarchy. Now, these newly emerged group, they wanted to redefine their position in society. And they spearheaded and articulated a new movement which is referred to as the Bhakti movement. They stated that God dwells in each and every one, and therefore you did not need the structures of the temple where one had to go and worship God. And therefore most of this demand came from the marginalized section of the society. Now, Bhakti as a concept was not something which emerged only during this period. It's a very ancient concept, and we can find traces of this even in the Vedic period. In fact, the Bhagavad Gita also mentions that one should give up all religious path and take refuge in God alone. And it talks about how, you know, one can practice yoga, one can take merge with God. And the word bhakti is derived from the root bhaj, meaning to adore. The word bhakti occurs for the first time in the Upanishads. In the Shvetvatra Upanishad, we have come across the doctrine of self-surrender and grace. In Katha Upanishad also, there is a mention of bhakti, because it states, to one who has the highest devotion, that is bhakti for God, and for his spiritual teacher, guru, even as for God, to him these matters which have been declared become manifest, a great soul. Yeah, become manifest, a great soul. This has been also repeatedly told in the epics, that to achieve liberation, one has to transcend all kinds of oppositions, including good and evil. The goal of the path is knowledge. The path of action thus becomes the same. The realization of eternal dimension of oneself. The Yoga Sutras also include a new element that concentrates on the idea of God and being an example of the liberation of soul. Therefore, we have the whole concept of bhakti which is present in many of the earlier texts. In fact, the whole concept of bhakti can also be seen as evolving in the southern region. If you look at the poetry of the Alwars, they were opposing the Brahminical domination, and we have a lot of bhakti which then moves from south to north, and slowly it spreads into western, eastern and northeast region also. Among the devices which were adopted by the bhakti saints, there was a lot of sporadic singing. They were seeking union with the God. They were talking of God as the absolute power who is symbolized in the image in the temple, and they emphasized a lot on emotional singing. There was also a protest element of protest and dissent in the Alwars and Nayanars, which was they were protesting against these privileged classes. Now, if you look at many of these hymns, we can see three very important features of bhakti in this. First, it talks about utmost devotion to a God. You know, it could be any God. You could see that God in any form. you know, some of the bhaktas saw this god as either a teacher, a friend, a lover, a husband. So, you know, it was just devotion to this ultimate god. And second, you know, they were also protesting against the orthodoxy of the Brahmins, you know, especially saying that divine grace and salvation is something which can be achieved by all. And they also denounce the Jains and the Buddhists as non-believers, and they were seen as heretics and the heterodox in nature. Now, by the time Bhakti reaches medieval India from 13th century to about 17th century, we can notice a large number of trends, and the whole character of this movement changes. And it was, in fact, this period gave a new lease of life to the whole concept of Bhakti. And this was primarily because there were a lot of new socio-economic forces that were emerging in this period. But before we go into that, let us first understand what is the meaning of the concept of Bhakti. The word Bhakti means devotion, participation, reverence, or adoration. It also, you know, to a common person, the term is understood only as religious devotion. You know, there are various terms. You can have Pitra Bhakti, you can have Matra Bhakti, you can have Desh Bhakti. But many of these bhaktas in the medieval period interpreted this as devotion to the Almighty or God. And we find it was primarily in the 19th century that people started focusing on this movement, and you had a lot of scholarly writings that came up, especially from the second half of the 19th century. The word was first used by H.H. Wilson to denote Krishna Bhakti of the Vaishnavas of Bengal. Monier William also did not just limit the word Bhakti to the Krishna cult, but he extended it to the whole of Vaishnavism. It was George Grierson who developed the whole idea of Bhakti as a religion, a cult, a doctrine. In fact, medieval period sees both Nirgun and Sakun Bhakti emerging at this time. In response to the Orientalist and Indological writing on Bhakti, there were works of a large number of Indian scholars who tried to show that Bhakti had its roots in India only. In fact, R.G. Bhandarkar and R.C. Zehner, they questioned the whole Christian influence which was seen in Bhakti, you know, and Bhakti was seen by them as indigenous in nature. In fact, Bhandarkar brought forth literary and epigraphical evidence to show the antiquity of Krishna worship and Vaishnavism. R.C. Zehner spoke about the Dravidian origin of Bhakti. Radhakrishnan traces the origin of Bhakti to Bhagavad Gita. He claims that Bhakti is in the Gita and it is sustained by knowledge, but it is not knowledge itself. Bhakti requires faith and emphasizes simple and austere purity of relationship between the surrendered and the one to whom you are surrendering. It perceives genuine piety in the competence of surrender rather than the intensity of the Bhakti discipline. Earlier, the Bhakti movement was only seen as a literary or at the best as an ideological phenomena which had religion at its base of inspiration. This was primarily because of the lack of emphasis on social history, and hence the socio-economic forces that went into the shaping of Bhakti movement were totally ignored, and Bhakti remained within the realm of literature, and most of the works were done from a very literary point of view, where one was analyzing the writings of the Bhakti, looking at their poetry, looking at their songs. But this lacuna was removed by many historians who started looking at this movement. Tarachand felt that this movement was very much influenced by Islam. Yusuf Hussain also felt that it was influenced by Islam. And Kamble started looking at the Bhakti movement as something, you know, which was attempting to bring about an egalitarian society. And even Malik, you know, who was talking about the whole movement, he looks upon the whole movement as a protest movement. R.S. Sharma looks upon the Bhakti movement as a product of the feudal society. And he looks upon this as a result of the expansion of the artisan classes. In fact, Gohin also looks upon the whole Bhakti movement as a result of the increase in commodity production as a result of trade expansion. Now, when we look at the background of this movement, we find that a large number of changes were taking place in India during medieval period. If you look at the political front, the whole country was divided into a large number of regional states. You know, in fact, in 16th century, when Babur comes to India, he finds a large number of feudal states like Bengal, Khandesh, Jaunpur, Bihar, Kashmir, Sindh in the north. The south also, you have the five states of Golconda, Bijapur, Gulbarga, Bidar, Barar, you know, which came up as a result of the disintegration of the Bahmani Empire. Again, on the economic front, the Delhi Sultanate witnessed a large number of changes. This period definitely saw an economic organization that was much superior than the earlier organization. The earlier phases of the Sultanate rule had released certain forces which led to a lot of expansion, alteration of agrarian conditions, and there was an increase in calf production and commerce. Now, this coupled with the increase in technology, use of technology, also added to the whole economic situation. In fact, if you look at the advances which are taking place, whether it is in sericulture, carpet weaving, cotton textile, you know, in the irrigation we were using the Persian wheel, and the paper was also being introduced at this time. There were new devices which aided navigation, and all this increased the economic activity during this period. And all this can be witnessed through an increase in the number of coinage, and there is a lot of transfer of stored silver and gold into minted money. In fact, one can also see a simultaneous increase in the slave trade market, and many of these slaves were used as cheap labor for the expansion of production. In fact, many of the sultans had their own karkhanas where a number of these slaves were involved, and one could see an expansion in a lot of these various crafts which took place. Now, many of the artisans who were working in these trades and crafts, they came from other groups. You know, there were people who came from outside the ranks. Now, these were not accepted by the general Indian artisans because, you know, many of these Indian artisans were bound in traditional custom-bound caste. And therefore, you know, you could witness a phenomena where these groups, you know, these artisan trading community, they had a lot of wealth, but they had no place in the hierarchy. You know, one can almost see a similar situation happening in 6th century. You know, when Buddhism is emerging, there is a lot of different groups, the merchants who are very powerful. And yet, the Brahminical society was not accepting them. They continued to be at a very lower status. And on the social front, you could see a lot of Brahminical oppression. The society was divided into these castes, and the outcaste had no social rights, they had no privileges, and they were not even allowed to participate in many of these sacrifices. And this was a period where Buddhism and Jainism had practically disappeared. And it was the orthodox Brahminism which was very supreme. And they alone had the right to read Sanskrit. They alone could understand these religious texts. And therefore, they became the via media between the people. And they were the ones who could perform all the rituals, the ceremony. This period is also characterized by the rise of the temple as a very important economic institution. In fact, the temple emerges as a citadel of power, you know, economic, social power during this period. It was the temples that were directing agricultural activities, and they were almost enjoying a power which was co-equal to that of the state. The temples directed agricultural development. They received a lot of endowments. In fact, endowments were made to in order to provide income for the temple maintenance. They were giving money for the performance of various festivals. The deities were being offered food in the temple. In fact, the temple became the citadel of the socio-economic activity during this period. Now, most of these temples were closely associated with the territorial and communal bodies in the administration of local areas. The temple was both a landlord and an employer. Its treasury was a bank which received a lot of deposit of money. Therefore, you know, all these factors resulted in the emergence of this Bhakti movement. Most of the studies on the Bhakti movement have seen this primarily from a very north-centric point of view. And it is assumed that these theoretical postulations would apply for the Deccan also. However, the movement in the Deccan developed in totally different way. The Bhakti movement in the north developed along two streams, the Nirguna Bhakti and the Saguna Bhakti. And it was at that time, you know, they were primarily the rule dynasties that were ruling were Islamic, and many of these Bhakti cults and the saints did not get any kind of royal patronage. However, on the other hand, in the Deccan, especially the region south of the Krishna river, was comparatively peaceful. It was free of any Muslim contact. And therefore, the movement here was not so much as a reaction to Islam as to eradicate the influence of Jainism and Buddhism. And that's what's the main difference between Bhakti as it emerged in North India and Bhakti as it emerged in South India. The movement in Deccan received a lot of patronage from the kings. The Pallavas were Vaishnavites, the Cholas were Shaivites, the Kakatiyas were also Shaivite, and the Vijayanagar kings patronized Sri Vaishnavism. Now, a cursory look at the Shaivite centers throughout the country gives us the kind of royal patronage that was given to these temples. And we can see more than 275 sacred sites of Saivites. These are mentioned in the Tevaram. Around 90% of these are located in the Kaveri Valley, which was the core Chola dominion. And most of the Vaishnavite centers are beyond this region, since the Cholas consciously patronized Shaivism. Whereas in North India, the dominant discourse is against Brahminism. In South India, there was a liaison between the royalty with that controlled temple rituals. And we often find a lot of them were employed in the state services. Temples emerged as very powerful institution in spite of opposition from Veer-Shaivism to temple. And therefore, we have to emphasize that, you know, there are a lot of complexities in the way this movement developed, both in North India as well as South India. Now, you know, another very important aspect with regards to the Bhakti movement is that they were talking about a new society. You know, they were opposing Brahminism, they were opposing temples, they were opposing hierarchies, they were opposing the rituals, and they wanted a different kind of society for themselves. But unfortunately, this society did not include women. You know, most of the bhaktas are only talking about this kind of liberty for themselves. They wanted a social change for themselves, and women are not part of it. This becomes very clear if we look at the attitude of many of the male bhaktas and what were their attitude towards women. So therefore, we find that many of these bhaktas could not rise about the age-old prejudice of looking at women as an impediment to salvation. You know, according to ancient texts, it is primarily Kanak and Kamini, you know, property and women that are impediments to salvation. And they continued to hold this view, and they were looking upon women as impediment. At one place, you know, Guru Nanak is a different voice, because he says, man is born from a woman. Within women, man is conceived. To a woman, he is engaged and married. Man is friend with women. Through women, the future generations exist. When this woman passes away, he seeks another woman. To a woman, a man is born. So why call her evil? From her, kings are born. From a woman, woman is born. Without her, the world there would be no one at all. So therefore, you know, except for this voice, we do not find any of the other bhaktas talking about women in these terms. Kabir talks about fundamental equality of all human beings, irrespective of birth, family status, caste, race, religion. And he felt that all human beings are born equal and they consist of the same element. He also refused to recognize the distinction between a ruler, a beggar, a high caste man, an untouchable, a Hindu, Muslim or a Turk. Yet, this did not apply to women, because he continues to see women as subordinate to men. In fact, in Kabir's discourse, we find that women are represented in very gender stereotypes, either as a woman, a wife or as a sati. In fact, in many of his writing, Kabir himself represents himself as a woman, you know, when he is writing his poetry. And he talks about himself as a slave of his lover. Yet, he is very critical of women, and he equates women with Maya and illusion. Kabir gives a lot of importance to the role of women as a mother. A woman's life is worthy, according to him, only if she gives birth to an intelligent and a religious son. If a woman cannot give birth to such a son, then it was better that she would have become a widow, or she would have aborted that child, or she would have remained childless all her life, you know, according to him. Again, he says, in fact, he prefers a dog of a Vaishnavite better than a mother who has given birth to a ill-gotten son. And he also talks about you know, in one of his poems, he talks about his mother who hides her tears and cries because her son has left weaving and became very involved in bhakti, and he does not take care of the financial health of the family. Kabir also talks about the economic contribution of women and regard her as being responsible for building the character of his children, especially his sons. The father is never mentioned as even being remotely responsible for shaping the character of his son. In fact, Kabir sees a woman only as a sati. According to him, a pativrata would give her mind and body to her husband and enter the pyre as if nothing is of any value to her in the absence of her husband. In fact, after ascending the pyre, the pious woman cries out in the graveyard that this is now her only destiny. The institution of marriage becomes very important to Kabir, and he talks about very strong ties. He says, in the beginning one form, Jiva, existed. In the beginning, light had its manifestation. Desire was made in the form of women. To her was given the name Gayatri. To that women were born three sons, Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh. Were these names given? Then Brahma asked the mother, who is thy husband and whose wife art thou? I am thou, thou art, and I am the one besides. Thou art my husband and I thy wife. Father and son have the same wife. One mother gives birth to both. Never have I seen a son so worthy that he sought out his father. Again, you know, he is very particular about a woman being very faithful to her husband. In fact, he is very critical of a woman who is of loose morals. He says in one of his poems, she was wife to one, she became the wife of many. The wanton has many maids. Kabir asks, with which will she burn? For she, wife of many husbands. Again, you know, he talks about adultery in one of his poems. He says, I have seen a woman walking, the pitcher below, the water carrier above. She was passing on along the highway. The bed was rested upon the sleeper. Dying of cold, yet she spares the quilt. She knows not her husband, the wife is demented. Evening and morning she lights the lamp. Leaving her husband, she dotes upon a lover. Night and day she is inebriated with love for him. To her own husband she speaks not the truth. She left her husband while he slept and went. Now to whom shall I make plain this trouble? Again he says, you know, the wife is called her husband, yet she sleeps with another. Folks abide in her heart. What joy can a husband have? Kabir, in fact, compares a fallen woman into the clutches, you know, falling into the hands of a treacherous woman as something which is worse than a snake bite or a scorpion bite. And he says this, you know, one, when one falls into the clutches of such a woman, it has no remedy. He says in one of his poems, there is charm for the snake and scorpion bite, and for the poison there are antidotes. If one falls into the clutches of a treacherous woman, she will tear out his heart and devour it. In fact, Kabir has many expectations from women, and he wants the women to be devoted as an obedient wife. He also makes fun of men who love women. In fact, he says women is another name for Maya, illusion, and she is the one who obstructs the path of salvation. He equates women with gold, with poisonous fruit, and she is the one who would surely lead to death. A woman to him is like a garbage bin of the world, and it is due to the trap of the women that, you know, the whole world is bound to be destroyed. Anyone who is closely associated with women, according to him, can never get salvation, because women destroys bhakti, salvation and knowledge. It is very ironical to see that the same Kabir, who is very critical of married life and blames the women as an obstruction to the path of bhakti and God realization, presents himself as a women bhakta seeking God within the parameter of family and husband-wife relationship, the relationship of a lover and beloved. In fact, in many of the poems of Kabir, he uses the imagery of love between husband and wife as the relationship between the individual soul, Atma, and Paramatma. He also compares the Atma to the devoted wife who eagerly awaits the return of her husband and thinks of different ways to meet him. A woman visualizes herself as a slave of her beloved and seeks his grace. She pines to meet her beloved and lovingly waits to meet him. In fact, her eyes become like stone waiting for him, and her tongue is full of blisters calling out her lover's name. So, you know, when Kabir is writing his poetry, he is imagining himself as a woman, and yet he speaks of women so harshly in his other poems. In fact, after a long agony and waiting endlessly, the lover finally meets his beloved, and she is able to sleep with him. Kabir also equates a woman with Maya, because she becomes the biggest obstruction to the path of bhakti. Kabir constantly mentions ornaments like bangle, payal, bichwa, har, kundal in many of, and he also mentions a lot of items of toiletry like kajal, sindoor. But the purpose of all this is for the women to decorate herself and wait for a swami, that is her husband. He also states that a good wife must win the affection of only her husband, and along with this, she also has to win the affection of her mother-in-law, father-in-law, the elders in the family, and the younger brother-in-law. So it's not just the husband, but the whole family to whom she has to, you know, obey. He also contrasts a devoted wife to that of a prostitute who sells her ware in the marketplace and entices the innocent and the unwary. He compares Maya to the prostitute, and she is equated with sinful being. You know, he refers to her as Papin, Dakin, Mohini. You know, these are the different terms that he uses. Associated with such women robs a man of wisdom, that is buddhi, and sense of discrimination. Such a man loses his vivek. Hence, to Kabir, there are only two categories of women. One, who are devoted wives, they are pativratas, sativratas, and the others who are prostitutes. There are no other women besides this. Again, you know, if we read Purandar Das, we find that he also is very critical of women. He says in one of his poems, "O you fool who desire women, touch her not with eyes, mind or body. It takes but a minute to fathom this enchantress as enemy. As lover she gives you pleasure and denies you eternal salvation, destroys the sanctity of your life on earth, and keeps you in the bondage through hundreds of birth. She is the one who begets you as a mother. As wife she destroys you by desire, taking so many different forms. Maya incarnates, she throws one of her tribulation." So, you know, what is very important, that many of these bhakti saints could not rise up above the traditional view of looking upon women as Maya, an impediment to the path of bhakti. In fact, Tulsi also divides women into two categories. One is the Uttam, women of high qualities, and the other is Neech, women of low qualities. The latter have to be kept under strict control, and they require a lot of surveillance. His expression is well known, that a drum, a villager, a shudra, an animal, and a woman deserve to be beaten. He states that if women become independent, they break loose like water channel in floods. He does not find the path of knowledge being suitable to women. The only path open to women, according to him, is service. He states that a woman can get recognition only through service rendered through her husband, and this happens to be the key component of achieving prosperity. In fact, all women portrayed by Tulsidas, like Kaushalya, Mandodari, Tara, who are very high quality women, are very devoted to their husband. It is the low quality women like Manthara, Taraka, Surpanakha, who can have a different standard. Tulsi echoes the traditional view of women, as stated by Ravana, that women have 8 negative qualities: foolhardiness, falsehood, waywardness, lustfulness, cowardice, lack of discrimination, suspiciousness, and cruelty. In fact, this is again echoed by Shiva when he warns Parvati of the suspicious nature of women. Ramcharitmanas finds it very difficult to understand the waywardness of women, as has been stated in the context of KKE. To him, women had 8 negative qualities, which are, mentioned again and again in the context of KKE also. In fact, he states that the waywardness of women is such that it is impossible to understand them. Earlier, even the workery tradition in Maharashtra is very critical of women. So therefore, when many of these bhaktas like Kabir, when they are talking about the economic contribution of women, they are being responsible for building the characters of their sons, they are only emphasizing on the contribution of women in the family. They do not mention anything about the father's contribution and how he is responsible for shaping the character of his children. To Kabir, a woman has to be seen only as a sati, and it is the pativrata who gives her mind and body to her husband, and she does not give importance to anything else. And he also mentions that there is an antidote for poison, but there is no antidote for these kind of women. And therefore, we find that many of these bhakti saints could not rise up from the traditional view of looking upon women as Maya, and they are the ones, who lead men away from the path of bhakti. And it is these, bhakti saints, though they are clamoring for so many rights for themselves, they are very critical of the existing society. They want to create a new society where, they have all the rights, but women are not part of this. And we find that, the bhakti movement, the dominant discourse of the bhakti movement is articulated by the men. And though they are protesting against the prevalent injustice, but this does not address the women. And it is a majority of the saints who are very critical of women. Of course, Tulsidas is a Sagun saint, but by and large, most of these saints are Nirgun saints. In fact, many of the Nirguns are revolting against idolatry, against the tyranny of caste and creed, against temple rituals, and the change, they are seeking a change, but women are not part of this change. They are talking about a lot of injustice prevalent in the society. But in the new order which they visualize, women are relegated into the domestic sphere as pativrata and sativrata. Women have no place in the change which they are seeking. The change them itself is defined by male parameters. The perception of change and the need to come to terms with it is almost synonymous with the ideology of a total change which they visualize. There is no attempt by any of these bhaktas to reorganize the power relationship within the family. And women by and large are excluded from this, and they are pushed back into the domestic sphere, and there is a reinforcement of patriarchal ideology. In fact, we cannot really blame the bhakti saints. They were depicting a reality of their times. Many of the bhakti saints lived in a society which was very patriarchal, and they were holding a very traditional view about the roles of women. And women were primarily seen as Maya, an impediment of bhakti. A woman was defined in terms of a contribution to a family. She had no status outside the family. And this is a view which is predominantly held by many of the bhaktas, we find this more among the Nirgun saint. It is interesting to note that many of these Nirgun saints came up from the upcoming non-agrarian sectors. They were associated with production processes like tanning, weaving, tailoring. And in all these spheres, women were slowly being marginalized. And therefore, you know, the prejudice against women becomes more sharp over here. Women have no change in this kind of change which is being visualized. And we find that the attitude of the male bhaktas, you know, they were not articulating any kind of rights for women. They were not trying to articulate for the change in production relations. But they just were referring to a kind of, you know, illusion. They were, you know, it was representing a kind of advancement, and yet the same system continued. Therefore, to conclude, you know, the Bhakti movement emerges at a time in medieval India. You know, it emerges around 13th century because of the change scenario. They pick up a concept from ancient India, you know, because we find mention of Bhakti in the Bhagavad Gita, in the Vedas, and they also pick up this whole concept, but it is given a new meaning in medieval times. And you have the Nayanars and the Alvars who were talking of Bhakti. They emphasized upon a personal God. They spoke of a casteless society. They spoke about love being very important. They spoke against the caste system, everyone being equal. But what is very important in the kind of change which they were visualizing? You know, the change had come about at a time where there were a lot of changes taking place in India. You know, politically, there was no strong centralized state. The whole country was divided into a large number of feudal states, which were very regional in character. The economic situation was such that you had an increase in the number of artisan craftsmen and trading activities. There were a large number of craftsmen who were joining these different caste groups, and they were becoming very prosperous. On the social front, the Brahminical tyranny was getting more and more intensified. There was a lot of orthodoxy which was coming in. So in this kind of a change scenario, the movement which comes from the lower caste, from these communities, they wanted a different kind of a society where all of them are, you know, equal. They do not need a hierarchical relationship. But what is interesting is women are not part of this change. They visualized a change only for themselves, and they continue to look upon women within family roles. They could not rise up from the traditional understanding of women as women being impediments to salvation. And therefore, you know, the change which they sought, women were not part of it. This in contrast to a large number of women who also came up as part of this movement, and they were speaking in a totally different terms. Thank you.